Benjamin Fulford's update from 5 December contains some rather controversial photographs of an alleged cabal dinner, wherein the main course was a human being. The photos were quite sensational, and the reaction from them was rather extreme. I received several emails from readers demanding that the photos be taken down and that I was helping to promote fear and negativity. Soon after Fulford's newsletter was released, a researcher revealed that the images were not actually real. They are from a 2007 film entitled Thanksgiving. But this event provides an opportunity to discuss the false belief that negativity exists outside of us. And that once the truth is recognized, one's personal powers of transmutation can be used to heal the mind and transmute darkness into light, which I would argue is the true meaning of the term light worker. Below is a discussion about the process of reprogramming the mind and transmutation of fear into love. I also provide the response I wrote that I shared with the Prepare for Change Google group. They inspired me to write this article as they felt what I offered in the response was of value. Thank you all who contributed to this effort. The information and methods described below will likely sound crazy or antithetical to how we've been taught to think about our relationship to the world. I merely offer that one should contemplate what is herein presented without casting judgment before honestly exploring the data. Even though the images were not genuine, the reactions felt by those who saw them were quite real. It seemed that some people thought it was irresponsible or in bad taste to share the images, saying that by doing so, myself and others were promoting a negative agenda and polluting the minds of the masses with fear. The premise being, in order to manifest positivity in one's life, one must strive for a high vibration. I think this is true, but the technique of always avoiding our fears in a way to maintain a high vibration, I would argue, is not the best solution. A balance must be struck between developing inner peace while at the same time facing our fears so they can be overcome. Before discussing the underlying premises that fear and negativity are outside of us, let's consider the topic of fear food or lush. According to several researchers and whistleblowers, there are evil extraterrestrials and extradimensional beings who feed on the energy produced by negative emotional states. It is essentially a form of energy vampirism, but to a much more nefarious and gruesome extent. Apparently, the Earth is managed by a group of beings who need to constantly promote fear, negativity, and disempowerment, through various venues like war, the media, and the social fabric itself. This is largely accomplished via mass mind control and social programming through culture, wherein each person's subconscious mind is filled with programs of fear that are triggered by encounters in experience, like the photographs discussed above. In this way, people can be easily triggered into producing fear or lush, unless they do the personal work of reprogramming the subconscious so that fear is no longer generated by certain stimuli. While the topic is somewhat fringe, even within the truther community, there is a valid scientific basis for the idea of energy vampirism and transmutation. Prana, chi, or qi are Eastern terms referring to life force energy produced by living things. Kirlian photography is one method of measuring this energy that is often regarded as the aura. But none of these phenomena is well accepted by the scientific community. However, biophotons are well accepted and there have been many peer-reviewed studies confirming that living things produce coherent light that seems to play an essential role in health and vitality. During negative emotional states, stress responses in the body produce an excess of vital energy, which if not organized coherently via various methods of integration, such as meditation, philosophy, and contemplation, lead to disease and lack of health. This excess vital energy can be consumed by the so-called energy vampires as lush or fear. Members of Professor Dr. Olaf Kruse's biological research team have confirmed for the first time that a plant, the green algae, Chlamydomonas reinhardtii, not only engages in photosynthesis but also has an alternative source of energy, it can draw it from other plants. The research findings were released this week in the online journal Nature Communications, published by the renowned journal Nature. The idea human beings can be milked of life force energy due to an emotional state of fear is valid. Many conclude that the solution is simply to avoid things that trigger fearful responses. And while this is a short-term way to deal with the problem, it is not an ultimate solution. The subconscious is filled with programs of fear designed to make us upset. Avoiding the triggers might prevent a fearful response for a time, but the overall quality of positivity is reduced as well. Instead of feeling inspired by each moment in life, the avoidance of fear tends to cause a numbing effect, a kind of chronic anxiety because a trigger might cross our path at any time. Thus, the ultimate solution is to reprogram the mind via self-mastery techniques, and in the process, the overall experience is greatly enhanced, approaching all-encompassing states of bliss and joy as more inner mastery and self-empowerment are gained. The fact is, fear, like beauty, is in the eye of the beholder. What one person fears is not the same as what another person fears, and this means that fear and the things that cause negative states of being are subjective. An individual's experience, knowledge, and personal choices, biases, assembled over a lifetime, provide the necessary mental structures in consciousness that produce fearful states and negative emotions. As a society, we are conditioned to think that objects or things in experience have inherent meaning, but this is not actually the case. The key difference between the objective and subjective realities is meaning. An object is devoid of subjective meaning by nature. As an example of this, consider that the Chinese language to one who has never seen Chinese has no meaning, it is a random set of symbols. But to one who speaks and reads Chinese as their first language, the symbols have very precise meanings. What this reveals is that all objective phenomenon has no personal meaning implicitly. We give things meaning by way of observation and the exercise of choice insofar as ideational association. Our beliefs, worldviews, and biases, molded by life experience and our choices with respect to them, provide the syntax in consciousness to imbue meaning onto objects in life. The object is merely an anchor or catalyst for our consciousness associations, molded by perception. This is why everyone's personal experience of the objective world is unique, despite commonalities also being present, because each person's point of view is unique. The mind and consciousness are the meaning-generating agencies of human beings. Anything you observe or focus on, whether directly or indirectly, a physical object or an idea, is given meaning by way of the subconscious. The subconscious is programmed with meanings over a lifetime of experience. What we see in life is assigned a definition created by an interaction between the conscious and subconscious mind. Consciously defined things are more within a person's control than those subconsciously defined. Once a meaning or program has been created, it never disappears, it simply settles into the unconscious once the conscious trigger is removed from a person's awareness. Thus, avoiding a trigger doesn't make the program go away. And in order to gain mastery over one's experience, becoming the captain of one's ship, methods of reprogramming that are consciously derived are the most empowering. Hypnosis demonstrates this meaning-generating power of the mind because the subconscious can be manipulated to a very high degree, literally changing what we experience. A person who loves to smoke cigarettes can be hypnotized, having their subconscious manipulated by another so as to alter pre-existing definitions. The next time the person who was hypnotized smokes, it makes them sick. Therefore, the foundation of all meaning and the basis of subjective experience is the mind itself, not the objective world. Objects in experience are images that the mind employs as catalysts or triggers to bring to the surface a meaning or subconscious program. By removing the trigger, the meaning and feeling that comes with it settle back into the unconscious, but the object itself is not the source of the meaning or subjective experience. While hypnosis or unconscious reprogramming methods can be effective in reorganizing the subconscious, they do not impart self-mastery or personal empowerment. Developing conscious methods that are inherently holistic are more empowering and provide the individual with the tools to face their fears real time. Of course, this is a lifelong skill to develop, and one should not judge themselves harshly if they are not there yet. Social conformity and standard meanings. The key point to understand is that everyone produces their own meanings for all things, by way of free will choice and past experience. But unfortunately, most of us have assumed that meanings are implicit within objects, largely because of social ubiquity or common reactions. For example, present an image of a couple kissing in a loving way and most people will say this is a positive image, it invokes a good feeling of happiness and joy. Present an image of someone holding a razor to their wrists with tears streaming down their face, and most people will feel sadness and regret. Thus, because many people tend to react the same way to certain images, it is a common belief that certain objects have the same meanings, and that the only correct meaning is the one everyone else agrees with. But it is more accurate to say that certain things are given standard meanings due to socialization. Culture teaches us that it is socially acceptable to hate one thing and love another. But there are no absolutes when it comes to personal meanings. All personal reactions are valid for the individual because they perfectly reflect the internal state of one's consciousness and subconscious programming. Because the mind can be programmed either consciously or subconsciously, populations of people are conditioned to develop similar meaning due to cultural association, via tradition, and collective experience. Social gatherings, of all sorts, provide a venue where individuals experience the same objective thing collectively, and through socialization, sometimes called peer pressure or conformity, a group of people is conditioned to react the same way to a certain stimulus. As an example of this, consider how quickly a bully that is popular can rally their friends against another person, a form of social programming and conditioning. The media, in all its varied forms, is arguably the most influential programming tool for the masses, conditioning the people to develop the same set of triggers or programs that form a cultural bias. Historically, Americans in the depths of the Cold War were culturally programmed to fear Russians, and anyone who was sympathetic to communist countries was labeled a communist. Meanings are self-generated, and as a result, they can be self-adjusted or changed. This is of prime importance for the discussion at hand. Many have assumed that because they feel fear or disgust as a result of seeing an image, that the source of this experience was the object itself. But what actually happened is that the object was a trigger or catalyst for the meaning that already existed within the person to come to the surface. As such, avoiding the trigger doesn't make the fearful program or definition go away, it merely suppresses it beneath the surface of consciousness. Transmutation or reprogramming the subconscious. If meanings are generated internally by an interaction between the conscious and subconscious mind, then avoiding a trigger only maintains emotional peace for so long, at the cost of fear in the future tainting all experience. The primary problem is that people have forgotten or never learned how to reprogram, transmute, their own minds, and as such, they resort to avoidance and suppression measures to maintain emotional stability. But as was just discussed, the source of emotional reactions is internal, only the catalyst or trigger is external. The definition we give to things is a kind of structure within consciousness that allows the energy of awareness to flow in either a constructive or destructive way. When we feel positive emotions, like love, inspiration, joy, and so on, the definition we have assigned to the triggering thing is coherent to some extent, and most importantly, it is accepted by the will. Conversely, negative feelings are a product of disorganized or dissonant structures within consciousness, a lack of order, and are often rejected by the will. Therefore, there are several dynamics to consider when attempting to reprogram the subconscious so that what was previously viewed as negative becomes positive. In order to transmute a negative into a positive, the goal is to reorganize the subconscious using various techniques. The more holistic and integrated our knowledge, the more likely an object in awareness produces a positive emotion or experience. But even if our definition is positive, if we reject it via the will, it can still produce a negative sensation. Consequently, the structure within consciousness is one factor, with our free will choice to accept or reject being the other. As an example, consider sexual stimulation. There are times when certain images and thoughts produce positive sexual sensations, arousal, but for most of us, unless we are in the proper setting to feel these sensations, they will be suppressed. When in privacy, sexual stimulation can be embraced and will likely lead to sexual expression, whether with another person or by ourselves. When at work, sexual arousal is often considered inappropriate, and therefore such sensations are suppressed, producing a feeling of embarrassment. The point is that what we feel internally should ideally be acknowledged fully, even though we might also seek to change it. Free will's power operates the strongest within the conscious mind, which means transmutation or reprogramming is best done as a holistic conscious process. In order to transmute a fear response into a love response, it must be acknowledged consciously, accepted for what it is, a program of fear we have created, and then efforts to expand the definition into a holistic, coherent structure can take place. Philosophy and a love of learning are essential tools for redefining programs within the subconscious. This is because these triggers allow our definitions to come to the surface so they can be infused with more data, research, and reorganized into a coherent understanding via contemplation, philosophy. But these skills have been so totally removed from our cultural knowledge base, it is difficult for many to understand how this process works. Culturally, we are taught to think that it is healthy to react with disgust and revulsion given certain stimuli. Conversely, we can acknowledge a thing as not desirable without also losing our internal state of peace and composure. The goal of self-mastery and a transmutation practice is to redefine how we see things, while also seeking to change them for the better if they are undesirable. In essence, we are striving to clean up a mess with joy and happiness instead of hatred and upset. Both emotional states will motivate us, but one is more empowering than the other. The fruit of holistic knowledge and truth-seeking. It looks like the man is being held down and a gun is pressed against his head. To many, this image invokes fear and trepidation. But is this the whole truth? Look at this portion of the photograph. Now it looks like the man is being given water, and this invokes a different set of meanings, likely positive. What this demonstrates is that our minds tend to produce meanings based on the data available to us via perception. If our knowledge is incomplete, confusion and disorder and the negative emotional states that come with them are likely to flourish. In other words, ignorance is not bliss, it leads to more fear and more negative emotions. In summary, the more of the truth we can internalize and understand, the more coherent our knowledge, the more likely our subconscious will produce a positive experience. And we are participants in the process of bringing joy to our lives. Happiness is not the product of random chance, it is a technique for manifesting joy in our lives proactively, ideally founded on a wholehearted desire to seek the truth. This is a critical point to understand, as it proves why always avoiding things that cause us fear or revulsion prevents the conscious mind from reorganizing them via research and contemplation. If someone fears death, and never researches spiritual realities, out-of-body and near-death experiences, and the like, the data set within their knowledge base will be woefully inadequate and disorganized. The resulting emotional experience produced by the stimulation, idea, of death will likely produce fear, anxiety, and uneasiness. Conversely, when one faces their fears, accepts them, expands their knowledge as much as possible and takes the time to integrate what was researched so that a coherent understanding is formed, positive emotional states are more likely. It should be noted that coherence of data in the form of knowledge can take place with limited data sets. Even though one does not possess complete knowledge, if what they do have is organized or makes sense to them, then it will likely be accepted and produce a positive state. For example, the myth of Santa Claus, who brings children Christmas gifts if they are good, can produce a positive feeling if it is coherently understood within the mind of the child. Thus, while striving for truth is the best policy as the truth is coherent by nature, false knowledge and beliefs can fill in the gaps within our knowledge base, providing a short-term way for coherence to yield positive emotions. But the price of self-deception is that in order to protect one's beliefs to keep them coherent, an individual will need to avoid any data that dispels them. This is one reason why people tend to reject any information that goes against their belief system, because it would destabilize the coherence of their knowledge base. But dispelling one's personal illusions is essential to proactively prepare themselves for future experiences. Thus, a technique of holistic integration and truth-seeking, while more turbulent at first, eventually provides the skills to overcome fear and navigate the uncertainties of life with ease. Moderation versus chronic fear avoidance. It should also be noted that while avoidance of our triggers is over the long term disempowering, we also mustn't push ourselves too hard. If we try to transmute or face our fears more than we can handle, trauma is the result. Consequently, a balance between facing our fears and setting them aside is desirable. We need not bite off more than we can chew, else we might choke. Transmutation or reprogramming of one's mind requires a feeling of safety and love, a space of vulnerability and a holistically integrated state of consciousness. Therefore, developing that inner space of peace and stillness before exploring our triggers will be helpful. Once we've lost inner composure, this would be an indication that we need to step away to regain it. The balance is to not spend too much time in either register. We can't avoid our fears forever, nor should we force ourselves to deal with more than we can handle. The middle path of balance seeks to integrate both methods, striving to constantly improve and enhance our mental and emotional discipline via self-mastery attainment. But the path of fear is different. When we always, chronically, avoid our fears, and never make an effort to face them, we are on the path of fear and avoidance. And in such cases, the individual could be dealing with a serious level of trauma and personal disempowerment, requiring a gentle and loving environment to heal, or they could simply be in a chronic pattern of avoidance. But still, even those who suffer from high amounts of trauma can be tempted to avoid all fears all the time, which is impossible to maintain. Thus, being proactive about facing one's fears is better than trying to do the work only when in the midst of a reaction. Those who choose the path of fear and avoidance, out of egoism, in an effort to stay pure or maintain their beliefs, are fighting a losing battle. Eventually, no matter how adept someone is at avoiding reality, the weight of denied truth eventually destroys a person's illusions. And a lifetime of avoidance produces a fearful, an arrogant personality. The price of avoidance is a life that becomes increasingly hateful and intolerant because one needs to constantly be on guard to protect the delicate fabric of their inner world. Dogma and blind belief in one's illusions usually results in a zealot-like mindset, wherein anyone who dares to question the status quo is seen as an enemy that needs to be avoided or attacked. In summary of this section, the ideal state of being is one where our internal powers of consciousness allow us to navigate the uncertainties of life with grace, love, and bravery. The middle path of balance recognizes that inner peace and composure, along with willpower and discipline, is needed to face one's fears. When that inner composure has been lost, we can avoid our triggers to regain stability. But if we are always avoiding, then we must dare to question our methods and goals, and seek out healing protocols so we can forge ahead once more. Finally, while it is desirable to face one's fears, that doesn't also mean we must constantly be forcing ourselves into dangerous situations. For example, if we did find ourselves at a cannibalistic dinner, trying to get out of that situation would be a wise course of action. But once we are in a safe place, contemplating those experiences fully so we can face those fears in the comfort and safety of a secure place would be advantageous. There are no black and white answers when it comes to inner work and the art of gaining self-mastery. It is an art because it is a creative holistic process, a blend of science and improvisation. It is a process and a skill, meaning we can't put the cart before the horse, so to speak. A child needs to learn how to use their body over months of time before they have enough skill to walk or run. Many of us, due to the environmental conditions of life in this world, never developed internal mastery and emotional healing skills. Before we can transmute fear and pain on the battlefield, we must train and gain those skills in a safe and secure environment. Taking a well-known figure from religion as an example, Jesus didn't walk on water when he was 4 years old. He wasn't performing healing or speaking to the masses until he was ready and had those skills firmly in hand. Similarly, our quest to gain self-mastery must be one of humility and a recognition that we can only make progress in a careful fashion. Our zeal to be at the finish line won't get us there any faster. So take your time and don't bite off more than you can chew, but also don't let the food get cold on your plate. The aforementioned text was merely a brief summary of the techniques of self-mastery, discernment, and mind reprogramming. But what should be apparent is that avoidance of the things one fears doesn't make them go away, it actually allows them to continue to live on inside us. Therefore, the policy of always avoiding our fears actually produces more anxiety over the long term, which means there is more fear food or lush available to be consumed by energy vampires. What's worse, the things we fear and avoid also provide a cover of ignorance so that untold crimes and horrors can take place in our world. Now that I have taken the time to explain some of the mechanics of meaning, emotions, and energy vampirism, consider my response to a reader who asked me to take down the images of the cannibal dinner posted by Fulford. They asked me to remove them because they said they are trying to avoid creating fear within themselves by maintaining mental purity. Thanks for the feedback. As I am sure you know, the pictures weren't genuine. But on the suggestion of choosing not to post the pictures due to the potential to cause emotional upset, that is a dicey issue I think we should discuss in more detail. I think part of the problem we face on Earth is indifference, mainly due to the fact that so many people are shielded from the hardships of this world. While many of us care to some degree, on the whole, most people don't care, are indifferent, to the extent that harmful actions are left unchecked. It is easy to ignore an issue when you don't have to feel anything about it. Not to say you personally are ignoring things, we're just discussing the overall premise of avoidance. So let's discuss the technique of shielding ourselves from reality in an effort to keep ourselves pure. As a general principle, I tend to post information that could be triggering because, in short, people need to be triggered. The fact that the Fulford photos aren't real doesn't mean those horrific things aren't happening on Earth. These things are all hidden under the dirt, as it were, and flourish due to pandemic ignorance. So if people are triggered and feel icky, then this is probably a good thing and a healthy reaction. With this energy, we can motivate ourselves to stop the harm collectively. This is where the inner work can begin, so that the fear we personally create by seeing such things can be turned into love, which I think requires acceptance and embracing the whole truth, along with forgiveness for what is embraced. Embracing, in this sense, does not mean complacency, it means accepting reality in fullness, the good and the bad, so that the disorder of this world can be healed. For example, if we get sick with a virus, ignoring reality won't empower us to take healing steps. Thus, accepting the truth of our sickness is essential, while also striving to overcome it. That is what embracing the whole truth means. The spiritual warrior or light worker bravely accepts the truth about evil while striving to be a force for change to transmute darkness into light. Here's an analogy that I think is helpful. If we are sitting in a room with dog shit all over the floor, covering up the smell doesn't make shit go away, it just makes it easier for us to sit in it. Avoiding the shit-filled room might make us feel better, but the mess is still there and someone else will have to clean it up if we don't. The issue of pedophilia, cannibalism, human trafficking, drug addiction, hunger, and every other horror of this world is the same, I think. The people at large, who are responsible for allowing these things to continue on their watch, need to be roused out of their state of complacency and indifference so that the mess can finally be cleaned up. We need to smell the stink and collectively decide, it's time to take action. These are holistic problems that require holistic solutions, meaning we all collectively contribute to the mutual reality we create for ourselves. The timeline of positivity is founded on the whole truth in my understanding. The darkness of this world will remain dark and unhealed if we who have the light within shield it by avoiding dark things. This, I think, is a great psyop of the false New Age movement, that we need to avoid darkness and somehow this will allow us to ascend. Things, in reality, are not inherently negative, they are seen as dark by you, the observer, and when you turn away from this darkness you have created, it breeds into more darkness within you. This is one meaning of Yoda's statement about fear being the path to the dark side. It is the cabal's trick, so to speak, to get people to react in fear, as so many do, then try to hide from that fear within themselves by avoiding their triggers. This way the very people who are trying to stay positive by avoiding their fears actually become vessels of darkness and fear, because their fears are still there under the surface. Thus, the only way to stop the cycle is to face the fear, love it, heal it, allow it to wash over us, and transmute the darkness into light. This can only happen with knowledge, awareness, and love of the whole truth, not rejection and avoidance of reality to maintain an illusion of positivity. In this way, we steer the collective consciousness of humanity towards a positive timeline and future by empowering ourselves with the whole truth. In short, we create Lush by allowing the offer of fear to be accepted within us. We create Lush by refusing to do the inner work that transmutes fear into love. No matter what image, story, or idea enters our mind space, our spiritual powers will transmute it back into the love and light that it always has been, but only if we learn how to do that work. For evil, negativity, and darkness are only illusions, a state of disorder that festers within our mind when we fear and reject the truth. In this case, the truth about the horrors that are happening in this world because as a people we've chosen to ignore them. However, most who are reading these words have at least begun to walk that path of truth and light, yet most of the population has not. Now this being said, there is a difference between sharing something that is usually seen as dark and fearful and actively trying to scare people. I will always focus on sharing the whole truth, both the dark and the light, and encourage the readership to go within and use their light to transmute and heal any darkness that rises up within. But, I will not actively promote or try to scare people simply for the act of doing so. I hope you see and understand that everything I do on this site is motivated to raise the consciousness of humanity, so they become better truth seekers and develop self-mastery. One of the fruits of self-mastery is the ability to transmute our consciousness, in this case, to face one's fears and transform them into love and light. When this happens, the next time we see those images, we are filled with love and joy, not because we've brainwashed ourselves to do so, but because we've infused them with so much truth they become reflections of all that is. This is the essence of what our work here as Light Warriors is all about, I think. I do suspect Fulford is a man that has his own demons, so to speak, and might even be an agent of the Cabal, or at best, is being used by them. As such, and this of course goes with all things, personal discernment of what he shares is advisable. And if discernment is done properly, disinformation is key information to the self-mastered mind. I've learned a lot using this method. Thanks for sharing your thoughts and feedback. I hope what I offered adds some clarity as to why I chose to share those images and what you can do to change how you see them and what our work here as spiritual warriors is all about. In closing, let me say I appreciate and honor the feedback given to me by the readership. It helps me in the work I do for myself and others. As a people, we have been trained to turn away from our fears and the bad things in life, but in doing so, whether inside of us or happening in the world, we prevent ourselves from changing. As individuals, the more we avoid our fears, the more that the cancer of fear spreads within us. As a collective, the more we avoid our fears, the more the things that are hidden behind them continue to adversely affect our world, such as the many crimes against humanity now coming to the surface in this time of apocalypse. Find within yourself the courage and resolve to embrace the path of love and acceptance. Find the strength to face your fears and reorganize your mind space so that you become a wellspring of light, forgiveness, and healing. I think our purpose in this world is to bring order to chaos, which is an interpretation that is quite empowering, I think. But so long as we indulge in fear and avoidance, the power of inner light cannot heal ourselves or the world. Become the master of your own consciousness and the darkness of fear will no longer wreak havoc in your life. Darkness embraced is the exploration of mystery and the act of plumbing the depths of the unknown. The path of love and light is the practice of bringing your light into the darkness, bringing order to the chaos of ignorance and indifference. Justin.